Well, there it is, the US chart for this week. Thank you very much, Paula. As you probably noticed, as Lou has pointed out, I've learned to lean back because apparently I tend to lean forward all the time as if I'm being a bit aggressive. But now I'm leaning back like Mariah Carey. And is the shirt all right? Okay, let's get serious for a moment. A band that's just toured here. Obviously, the Australians absolutely love this band. And why not? They've had four great albums. And of course, I'm talking about Live. And we had the great pleasure of having Chad pop into the house to talk about not only the tour, but also of the album, The Distance From Here, and also about the new single called Run to the Water. So let's go right now to the couch over there. I don't know how we're going to do this, but my producer Lou and David are magicians, and they can go like that, and there it is. Chad, welcome to the house, welcome to Australia, and welcome to all these car heads.
Yeah, man, I can't wait. This is great. I love it down here. It's incredible.
Well, I mean, and obviously, I mean, the Australian public love you as well, you know, because an album to debut at number one, which is the fourth album for you, the single doing so well, and, I mean, this band just keeps getting bigger and bigger worldwide.
Massive by stealth. Yeah. That's been the theme of our career, I think. It's rather interesting, you know, because we can sell out arenas in almost any country in the world, but yet if you walk up to the average person on the street and you say Live, you know, compared to say, you know, I don't know, maybe Green Day or whatever, mm-hmm. one of the other, you know, trending bands, you know, they'll know the other band, but they won't know Live. But yet, you know, we're probably playing your arena in your town that night selling it out.
Absolutely. All right, can we just go back to Pennsylvania? What was the band's aims, you know?
What was our name?
No, what was your aim?
Oh, what was our aim?
I don't know what your name was. What was your aim?
Well, I'd rather talk about my name, really, because it's not actually Chad. No, I'm just teasing. Well, you know what? To tell you the truth, when we were 13 and 14 years old, that's how old we were when we started the band. Mm. I mean, our goals were primarily very simple. You know, learn to play our instruments better. You know, maybe try and play the corner bar, hopefully pick up some girls out of it. You know, the basic boyhood rock band thing. But when we really started to get serious was when we first started experimenting with writing our own songs. Mm. And once we learned that music could be such a huge form of self-expression, we really, you know, started to indulge ourselves in that. And I would probably say, you know, looking back now anyway, after Mental Jewelry and Throwing Copper, we started to really learn that not that the music wasn't just about self-expression, that it could actually be a voice for change. Mm. You know, sort of a reason to commune. You know, a great example is, you know, a big arena show.
Sure.
You get, you know, 20,000 people together in one room singing. It makes the world seem a lot smaller, you know, and I love that.
When you were 14 and 15, and I'm certainly not knocking Pennsylvania, please don't read it this way, but I mean, like, you have, like, you know, like, there's like Philadelphia, and you've got New York, etc., etc., and Penny is sort of locked into that triangle, but it's right in the middle, and it's a beautiful, I mean, city, etc., etc., but what is it like? Just paint the picture of what Penny is to the Australian public.
Yeah, right? Well, you know, York, Pennsylvania is a small industrial town of about 50,000 people, but it has a very rough inner city that, you know, actually that Time magazine listed as the crack hub of the East Coast of America. So it's actually quite a violent place. And we grew up in the inner city, all with living within a mile radius of each other. Mm. Went to, you know, elementary school, middle school, and high school together. But, you know, it's sort of interesting because I think that one of the tags that's always put on our band is earnest. You know, they always say, oh, they're earnest guys. And that can be used, you know, both as a positive thing for us or a negative thing. Mm. But the truth is, I think that if you look back to us being, you know, such young guys, that's really all that we knew to be. I mean, we didn't grow up around other bands or other groups, so we couldn't contrive what we were doing to be cool or trend-setting or whatever. Mm. For us, it was just, we really came from this heartfelt place. And, you know, I think that if you look at that and you don't understand the history of live, that maybe you would take songs like Run to the Water or The Dolphin's Cry as being maybe, you know, a little bit too heartfelt or something like that. Mm. But the truth is, that's who we are as people. And in now to deny that would just be to deny who we were. I think, in particular on The Distance to Here, we just tried to push that, you know, it's really a message of universal love. Mm. And I think Secret Samadhi was just a period of, you know, really sort of sorting out who we wanted to be as a band and as people, or even if we wanted to be a band and we wanted to continue on. Certainly with the success of Throwing Copper, it sort of it spun us into a whole different frame of mind.
Okay, with Throwing Copper, did it make you become maybe more, not more serious as songwriters, but think, my God, people are listening to our songs?
Yeah, exactly. And I think Secret Samadhi was our way of escaping from that for a little bit to sort of, you know, I don't know, I like to refer to it sort of as a huddle. You know, we all got together and sort of figured out what we wanted to do. And, you know, what's really interesting, though, as I look back on it, is that my relationship with all my friends and my family, and it went through radical change just in the way that we all related to each other, which is a real shame that that had to go down that way, but it did. And at the end of the day, we sat up in a rehearsal studio in LA, and it was going to be the first time that we made music together for like a year and a half. And I didn't even know if we were still a band or if we would write songs, but somehow we all put on our instruments, and I realized there's been all this radical change, and we have all made money and been successful, and all our relationships with our parents have changed. But the one thing that stayed the same was the four of us guys and our love for music. And that's what drove me to write The Distance to Here and to work as hard as I could. And I know the rest of the guys in there writing. I mean, it just became this, you know, if we're going to have a voice, let's have a positive voice. Let's have a place, you know, reflecting back again on, you know, John Lennon in his later stages, where he realized that if he was going to have a voice, he could use it to unite people. And I think that we're trying to pick up where he left off and just go on from there. Well, The Dolphin's Cry, we picked it as the lead-off track probably the day that we wrote it. I was sitting in my garage in Lancaster, and Ed had flown in from Los Angeles. He said, I wrote this great new song. He sat there on acoustic guitar and played The Dolphin's Cry, and I said, our album's done. That's what we were waiting on. We're waiting on that song. And we went in the studio actually the week afterwards and cut it as a band. And it got even more powerful when the band hit it. And I think lyrically, you know, Ed would say it's a song about, you know, freedom. It's a song about love. And, you know, it's very traditional in a live vein that way. It somehow, you know, evokes water. You know, our water.
Has he always had that vocal ability?
Yes, always. I mean, from day one, he could sing. There was no doubt about that. And I've noticed that his ability to write melodies has come so far. It's actually grown hand in hand with his ability to be able to play the guitar. I think that the more that he has learned to be a singer-songwriter of his own entity, writing songs like The Dolphin's Cry, I mean, I had nothing to do with it. I just sat back and went, wow, that's fantastic. Mm. Let's go cut it. And what a great thing to be in a band with a guy that can do that.